Do not look to us for kindness. Do not look to us for hope. We are not the kind children of this new age. We are the rocks of its foundation. If you wish hope, then look to what we make. If you wish kindness, then look to those who will come after us. The Legiones Astartes are the single deadliest armies forged by the Master of Mankind. Both the greatest defenders and mightiest foes of humanity, the constitution and strength of the Space Marines of his Imperium shoulder the great burden of humanity's survival. Yet among all the founding legions, one above all has garnered a legacy as the bulwark of humanity. The stoic bastion of the Imperium, the Imperial Fists. Holy Terra is the great bastion of humanity, though its resplendent present and once glories all stem from its savage origins. Once the battleground for 100 savage wars among the techno-barbarian hordes of humanity's past, with the ascendance of the Master of Mankind, order would be brought to the planet. His Thunder Warriors would purge the planet of the rabble of the Earth, and in their wake, a new breed of warriors would begin a new age of prosperity. To plant the seeds of the future, the soil of Terra would be nourished with the blood of the expendable Thunder Legion, and with the harvest of human potential ripe for picking, an army of angels would befit its protection. The Emperor would craft the Legiones Astartes and gift to them many traits and duties to fulfill their role as the custodians of humanity's bright future. 20 legions would be made, yet one alone would be tasked as the Praetorians of Terra. Drawn from every civilization of the Earth, the 7th Legion would be formed of the promising youths with a hunger to act in the name of the burgeoning Imperium. Enduring the painful surgeries and trainings to transform into the Angels of Death, traditions and unifying traits would begin to influence the Legion's character. Seeking to not only defeat the foes of the Imperium, but to add their might to its early formation, the 7th Legion would make any sacrifice to ensure victory. Securing great victories paid in blood, the 7th Legion's creation of great bastions upon the soil of Terra would exceed 600 citadels within the first 10 years of their service. The perished Astartes of the Legion would be said to lie within the foundations of each bastion. The blood of their kin sanctifying the fortifications crafted by the 7th Legion. Replacing the old traditions and cultures of the disparate settlements of Terra, the palaces and strongholds built by the 7th would act as examples of the Emperor's vision for the future Imperium. Always moving from one task to another, the Imperial Fists would not linger as they enacted hammer blows to destroy their enemies and rebuild anew from their fallen outposts. Citizens would remark that the hand of the Emperor had descended and gripped with an unbreakable fist, to which the Emperor would derive the 7th Legion's new name, the Imperial Fists. Bestowing the laurels of victory upon their heraldry, the dutiful and stoic warriors of the 7th would accept such favor with grace and silent dignity. For soon, even greater glories would be inherited from the Imperium with the reunion of their Primarch, Rogal Dorn. Discovered upon the icy death world of Inwit by the House of Dorn, the Primarch of the Imperium would be discovered upon the icy death world of Inwit by the House of Dorn. Orbiting a dying star, the planet of Inwit, despite its harsh environment and hardy people, would show evidence of a once proud citadel within orbit. Dormant voidcraft watched silently above the pearlescent body of snow and frost, and bear witness to the ascension of the boy who would be known as Rogal Dorn. The peoples of Inwit brave the immense cold and feral beasts of the world within ruling clans that had once claimed dominion over the entire sector of their surrounding system. The ice hives of the planet, led by warlords and matriarchal figures, ruled their people with shows of technical prowess, such as orbital defense stations, trade, and void-worthy armies. The young boy would be adopted by the elderly patriarch of House Dorn and would be taught self-reliance, the responsibilities of ruling, and a wealth of life lessons which would mold the young Primarch into the indomitable man he would swiftly become. Quickly growing in stature and influence, Rogal would with time lead House Dorn into a new golden age of prosperity. Mastering diplomacy, strategy, and empire building, it would not be long before Rogal Dorn rose to become the Emperor of the Inwit Cluster. His adoptive grandfather would eventually die from old age, yet rest peacefully in the knowledge that his most cherished inheritor to his house's legacy would become an ever stronger and virtuous leader. Cherishing his grandfather's memory, on the days which Rogal Dorn would sleep, he would rest with a keepsake of his guardian at the foot of his bed. A fur-edged robe, once belonging to the Patriarch of Dorn, would comfort Rogal during his time of grieving and serve as a reminder of his duty to uphold his mentor's legacy. An exemplar of Inwit's culture, Rogal Dorn would rule Inwit for 40 Terran standard years until the arrival of the Emperor upon his homeworld. Ever diligent with curiosity for the mechanics of technology and expanse of his empire, Dorn would meet the Emperor's incoming fleet at the head of his restored flagship, the Phalanx. The single largest vessel known to Imperial space, the Emperor would be immensely proud of his son's accomplishments. Already the ruler of a star-spanning empire and capable of reviving a long-dormant relic from the Dark Age of Technology, Rogal Dorn had proven to be among the most resourceful of any Primarchs ever discovered. Greeting the Emperor at the helm of the Phalanx, Rogal Dorn would be welcomed into the fold of the Imperium. Bequeathing the immense space station to the Emperor, the Master of Mankind would years later return the Phalanx to Rogal Dorn, outfitted as the Mobile Fortress Monastery, housing his own Space Marine Legion, the Imperial Fists. Installed as the leader of the 7th Legion's armies, Dorn would command his Legion in his quest to recover the long-lost legacies of humanity. Initially observing his Gene Sons with silent judgment, Dorn would not engage them in conversation during their initial pledge to follow his commands. Dorn would watch them in battle, and after deeming them worthy of respect, engage them in conversation. There was much to do to improve the Imperial Fists to the standards that Dorn demanded, yet there was undeniable strength within them. Giving a single word of thanks to the Master of the Legion, Matthias, Dorn would command his men to form 30 regiments from the initiates drawn from Inwit, and for 6 solar decades, mold his Legion into his own image. Unable to lie to his peers, and embodying the greatest virtues of the Imperial truth, Rogal Dorn would stand as one of the single most venerated figures in Imperial history. Revered by the Ultramarines, Lunar Wolves, and other storied Astartes legions, the Imperial Fists would serve with an untarnished reputation as loyal servants of the Emperor. Horus Lupercal, Primarch of the Lunar Wolves 16th Legion, would remark, "If ever I laid assault to a bastion possessed by you, then the war would last for all eternity. The best in attack, matched by the best in defense. Victorious in innumerable conquests and compliances throughout the stars, the single-minded discipline instilled within the 7th Legion would prove exceptionally effective. Rogal Dorn would prove to be a genius in the arts of strategy, and though a cold and humorless Primarch, the rage of the Praetorian of Terra would be infamous. With Lehman Russ, Primarch of the Space Wolves, remarking that Dorn's rage was as swift and unforgiving as the falling edge of an axe. Dorn's uncompromising idealism would often cast his Legion in a dour light. Stone-like in their demeanor and unyielding in their duty, fractious relationships with other Legions would inevitably ensue. The Iron Hands and their Primarch, Ferus Manus, would join the Imperial Fist during a joint campaign so brutal that it would cause a near-unreconcilable schism between their ranks. The Emperor would recognize Dorn's Legion's affinity for fortification and task the Imperial Fists to construct bastions within the Imperial Palace. Sending the Iron Warrior's Primarch, Perturabo, into a fit of rage, the jealousy of the Lord of Iron would be clear to even the Astartes of his own Legion. The two Primarchs would from this moment on never see eye to eye and refuse to cooperate in future campaigns. The stubborn nature of the 7th Legion, combined with their near-flawless record of deeds, would foster resentment amongst their rival legions, which would be further reinforced during the dark days of the Horus Heresy. With the conclusion of the Ulanor Crusade against the Orc Menace, Primarch Horus Lupercal would be installed as Warmaster of the Imperium. The Emperor would return to Holy Terra to attend to his revolutionary webway project and task the Warmaster with continuing the Great Crusade in his stead. Though several Primarchs would balk at their own dismissal for the position of Warmaster, Rogal Dorn would accept the Emperor's decree with no hint of resentment or bitterness. Ever loyal to his brother, Dorn would idolize Horus for his unquestionable pedigree and deeds made in the name of the Imperium, and see to aiding his might in the further conquest of the galaxy. Ever a trusted advisor to the Warmaster, Dorn's glories were eclipsed solely by Horus, and his resolute nature would be a boon when contrasted with Horus's innate charisma and charm. His counsel imparted to the Warmaster, Dorn and his Imperial Fists would be recalled to Holy Terra to garrison the throne world as the Emperor continued his experiments within the Eldar webway. Yet with the absence of the Imperial Fists, the Warmaster would slowly be enticed by the temptations of the ruinous powers. Enacting the purge of the loyalist elements within his own legion and traitorous allies, Horus would openly rebel against the Imperium and the will of the Emperor. With the flight of the vessel Eisenstein and its crew, commanded by the rogue Death Guard battle captain Nathaniel Garrow, Rogal Dorn would be drawn into the conflict. Captain Garrow would be rescued by the Imperial Fists in his retreat from the servants of the Dark Gods, and upon the phalanx, inform Rogal Dorn of the Warmaster's betrayal. Refusing to believe that his cherished brother would betray the Imperium, Dorn's anger would be unleashed upon Garrow, nearly costing him his life. Yet with the intervention of the Remembrancer, Mercedes Oloton, evidence of the Warmaster's slaughter of his detachment of civilians and loyal servants would prove Garrow's assertions to be true. Calming from his outburst, Dorn would make haste for Holy Terra and dispatch a retribution fleet to confront the temporarily weakened traitor forces. With a third of his legion traversing to the Istvan system, Dorn would bring word to the Emperor upon the throne world of the impending civil war. Upon the arrival of the Imperial Fists of the Sol system, they would find Mars erupting in open rebellion as a schism of the Mechanicum waged. With orders from Malkador the Sigilite, the Imperial Fists would attempt to quell the insurrection. The galaxy burned as the traitors to the throne ambushed the Imperial Fist retribution fleet, and several proxy wars erupted across the galaxy. Horus had begun his crusade to destroy the Imperium, and the inevitable path he would carve would lead straight to the throne world. Dorn's remaining legion would be tasked with fortifying the Imperial Palace and orbital defenses of Terra. Walls would be erected, artistic statues of marble and venerated memorials inscribed with gold torn down. Replaced with gun batteries and brutish bunkers, the former glory of the Imperium's splendor would be supplanted with dull rockcrete to bear the force of the future war for humanity. The inner wall would be commanded by the Emperor as he led his custodians and Sisters of Silence in their defense of the demonic invasions from the beings of the warp. The outer wall would be led by Dorn and his Imperial Fists, and should either fall, humanity would be forfeit. The Sol system would be organized into defensive armadas set to slow the advance of the traitor invasion. Appointed as the Lord Castellan of the Imperium, Rogal Dorn would await the inevitable Siege of Terra. His most trusted captains would command each sphere of orbital defense, and when each layer fell, the survivors would retreat to the surface of Terra. Sol had become a fortress, the likes to which had never been seen, yet it would only slow the traitors in their inexorable onslaught towards the Golden Throne. The Alpha Legion would infiltrate the Sol system in their attempt to break the defensive lines of the Imperial Fists. Activating sleeper cells throughout Sol, the Hydra would begin their task of weakening the fortifications of the 7th Legion for the impending assault of the Warmaster. Challenging Primarch Rogal Dorn to decide the fate of the Solar War, the Primarch of the 20th Legion, Alpharius, would battle the Praetorian of Terra in single combat. The Pale Spear would clash against Dorn's chainsword, Storm's Teeth, as their most trusted Gene Sons fought and died by their side. Dorn would be victorious, and in slaying the head of the Hydra, purged the remaining Alpha Legion operatives within the Sol system. Yet despite the Imperial Fists' valiant defense, the traitors to the throne would not be stalled. With the aid of the White Scars, Blood Angels, Knights Errant, and Custodians, the Imperial Fists would brace for the assault of the Imperial Palace. Disparate bands of warriors of every stripe and creed would rally to face the Warmaster's forces as they hurled themselves against the walls of the palace. Countless loyalists and traitors would perish as a thousand battles ravaged the earth. Yet the Warmaster's attempts to destroy the Imperial Palace would fail. Reinforcements of the Ultramarines, Space Wolves, and Dark Angels were imminent in their proximity to the Sol system, and time had run out for the traitor's siege. Rogal Dorn, Sanguinius, and the Master of Mankind would board the Sons of Horus flagship, the Vengeful Spirit, and confront the Warmaster. Yet Dorn would be teleported far from the duel against Horus Lupercal, and after fighting through the bowels of the Warmaster's flagship, find his brother slain and father gravely wounded. Humanity had been preserved with the Imperial Fists serving as the backbone of the defense of the Imperium. Though the cost had been devastating, the 7th Legion had proven to be a stalwart paragon of the Legiones Astartes. The traitors would be repelled from Holy Terra, to which the Loyalist Legions would give chase. Fueled by vengeance for the wounding of the Emperor, Rogal Dorn would carve a bloody path through swathes of the fleeing forces of the deceased Warmaster. Yet his most hated rival, Perturabo, would not be satisfied with the destruction wrought against the Imperial Fists and lure Rogal Dorn into a deadly trap. The Iron Cage would be constructed upon the planet of Sebastus IV and prove to be an indelible mark of heresy in the eyes of the Imperial Fists. Leading the entirety of his legion into the Eternal Fortress, the might of the Praetorians of Terra would be blunted. Expending ammunition until their reserves depleted, and shattering their combat blades and swords against the armor of their foes, the Imperial Fists would show no quarter to their hated foes. The Iron Warriors would pay their lives dearly for every Son of Dorn slain, and if not for the intervention of the Ultramarines, led by Rebute Gilliman, the survival of the 7th would be called into question. Driving the Iron Warriors from the conflict, the Imperial Fists would be cleansed of their shame. In the wake of the civil war to decide the fate of humanity, the Legiones Astartes would be disbanded. Rebute Gilliman would draft the Codex Astartes and outline each remaining Loyalist Legion to be broken down into smaller, Codex-compliant chapters. The Imperial Fists would be transformed and distribute its remaining members into the Crimson Fists, Excoriators, Iron Knights, Fists Exemplars, and Black Templars chapters. As the successors of the 7th persecuted the fleeing traitors during their transit to the relative safety of the Eye of Terra, Rogal Dorn would demand reprisal against the traitors for 2 decades. The Imperial Fists would replenish their numbers as their successors gained glory throughout the galaxy. Rogal Dorn would seemingly perish during 781.M31, during Abaddon the Despoiler's first Black Crusade, though no evidence for his death would be recovered, save for his severed right hand from the bridge of the vessel, Sword of Sacrilege. Interred as a relic of the chapter, the skeletal hand of Rogal Dorn serves as a reminder of their Primarch's sacrifices made to humanity. For in the 41st millennium, the Imperial Fists retain a record of great virtue, no matter their losses or countless martyrs, made in the name of the defense of the Imperium. Regarded as the single most venerated and respected legion, second only to the Ultramarines, the Imperial Fists are a reminder of the Imperium's gloried past. the heraldry of the golden yellow of their former legion, emblazoned proudly upon their armor. Each company is denoted by the trim of their pauldrons. The heraldry of the clenched fist stands proudly on their left pauldron, while their squad identifier is stamped with high Gothic numerals on the right pauldron, superimposed by their tactical role. Sergeants of the chapter wear red helmets centered with a white skull on its brow. Veterans wear white helmets, whilst veteran sergeants retain the accustomed red helmets with a white stripe. Lieutenants wear yellow helmets with a red and white stripe akin to the conventions of the Ultramarines chapter, with their right pauldron heralded with a starburst icon. Captains wear a simple yellow helmet stamped with a white skull and are honored with elaborate winged skull icons on their right pauldron. As an intensely compliant chapter of the Codex Astartes, the conventions of rank identifiers outlined by the tome bear unity to several cousin chapters. Tech Marines of the Imperial Fists adorn their armor with the red of the Tech Adepts of Mars, whilst librarians paint their armor blue, and chaplains honor the Reclusium by coating their armor in black. Several specialists comprise the Imperial Fists, each with their own doctrines of battle. The Templar Brethren served as the elite of the Legion during its service of the Great Crusade and Horus Heresy. Guardians of the Temple of Oves aboard the Phalanx, the warriors of the Templars epitomized unending zeal and martial skill. Bearing ancient Archaeotech armor and weapons, these close combat specialists would lead the most deadly engagements against the enemies of the Legion and subsequent chapter. The Phalanx Warder Squads contain the former Legion's Breacher Siege Squads. Armed with boarding shields, the Phalanx Wardens would be stationed primarily aboard the Imperial Fist flagship to blunt any incursion made against the mobile Fortress Monastery. Duty would be their only reward, as these Guardians of the Phalanx would bear little heraldry and seek glory only in the defense of their bastion. The Huskars would be reinstated by Rebute Gilliman during the Era Indomitus to reflect the past glories of the position during the Horus Heresy. Once the honor guard of Rogal Dorn, the Huskars would now be tasked with defending Imperial forces upon worlds of critical importance to the Imperium. Knowledgeable in governance and masters of planetary defense, the Huskars rally Astra Militarum regiments in their defense of humanity's strongholds, akin to their glorious defense of the Solar War. Veterans of the Siege of Terra would be given wall names to reflect their deeds, with examples being Slaughter, Cold Eye, Killshot, and Severance. With Rogal Dorn earning the title Defiance in honor of his protection of the Imperial Palace. With such titles as Seneschal, Castellan, and Centurion now retired from the chapter's service, the chapter master bears the sole responsibility of leading the Imperial Fists into the Era Indomitus. The Era of the Great Crusade would mark the 7th Legion as among the mightiest, if not largest, of the Legions, at approximately 100,000 Space Marines strong. Maintaining the largest fleet within the Legiones Astartes, the Imperial Fists would, prior to their conflict against the Warmaster of Chaos, amass over 1,500 void ships within their armada. Led by their gargantuan flagship, the Phalanx, not even the numerical superiority of the Ultramarines, nor Sons of Horus, could match the Imperial Fists' naval might. Sparingly changed from the origins of the Legion's organizational structure, from its formation of the Unification Wars, with time, the traditions of the 7th Legion would nonetheless erode. Squads would comprise of large amounts of assault units and special weapons experts, armed with missile launchers, las cannons, and multi-melters, to enable the destruction of armored vehicles and fortifications. Heavily favoring tactical dreadnought armor, including its Indomitus pattern variant, the Imperial Fist's reliance on heavy armor would further bolster their proclivity for fortification. Compiling as many as several hundred squads into each company, the amount of Astartes deployable by the 7th Legion would vary as the heresy induced untold casualties. Companies once grouped together would form battalions, with pairs of such battalions changing names from regiments to crusades and households. Led by their first company, the Templars, this band of 1,000 Astartes would encompass the greatest strength of the Legion brought to bear. swearing oaths of loyalty to the Emperor and their Primarch within the Temple of Oaths, within their voidship, the Phalanx. These exemplars of the Legion would not only be great warriors, but also paragons of the Creed of the Seventh. However, with the sundering of the Legiones Astartes and losses incurred from the disastrous Battle of the Iron Cage, the Seventh Legion's might would greatly diminish. As a Codex-compliant chapter of the 41st millennium, the Imperial Fist chapter has verged on the brink of extinction, only to be reborn from the ashes of its former glory. Fervent in their compliance to the Tome of the Ultramarines Primarch, the chapter combines its available battle groups and warriors to form balanced companies comprised of 100 Astartes. Upholding their former legion's traditions of siege warfare and urban skirmishes, the Imperial Fist deploy 5 battle companies and 5 reserve companies to mete out the Emperor's justice. The first company, the Emperor's Shield, comprises the elite veterans of the chapter. Commanded by First Captain Darn of Lysander, the Terminator-clad veteran company, also known as the Fists of Dawn. Under the command of their leader, forge a path through the greatest foes of the Seventh. The first sergeant of the company guards the vaunted relics of the chapter, with all veteran sergeants abandoning their names and adopting battle honors, one within their dueling arenas. The second company, the Scions of Redemption, bear the shame of their chapter's near annihilation during the War of the Beast. Fighting the enemies of the chapter in order to absolve their collective guilt, service within the second company is not, however, to be considered a dishonor among the chapter. For the Scions of Redemption are ennobled with their cause to diminish the past sins of their chapter and stride into battle alike to a deadly mechanism of war. The third company, the Sentinels of Terra, are renowned for their bravery and stubborn refusal to retreat from battle. Almost annihilated during the closing of the 41st millennium, the third company are, despite their chapter's rigid battle doctrine, adaptable combatants. Replacing their continual losses with members of the reserve companies, recruits to the Sentinels of Terra spar with the company's sergeants in honor duels to prove their resolve. The fourth company, the Victors of Brax, employ siegebreakers and overwhelming firepower to bring their enemies to heel. Once known as the Reductors, under the command of the legendary 7th Legion Astartes, Fafnir Ran, the company would change their title after their victory against the Alpha Legion during the Battle of Brax. The fifth company, the Heralds of Truth, preserve the chapter's scriptum, Ascender. A tome penned by Primarch Rogal Dorn, detailing his blunt observations and strategies of the Horus Heresy, members of the Librarius and Reclusium aid the fifth company in their guardianship of the sacred texts despite their gradual decay with the passage of the millennia. Bearing banners and relics from the Legion's former glory, the Heralds of Truth pass down the deeds and history of their chapter. The sixth reserve company, the Siege Hammers, are experts of siege warfare. Personally founded from the veterans of the Battle of the Iron Cage by Rogal Dorn, the sixth company aid their brothers with heavy firepower should the need arise in battle. The seventh reserve company, the Guardians of the Phalanx, are charged with the maintenance and protection of the Imperial Fist battle station, the Phalanx. The captain of the seventh company ritually removes their primary heart to be interred within a device crafted from the Phalanx. Causing heavy pressure to be felt upon the captain's chest at all times, the ritual reminds the captain of the 7th Company of his duty to preserve the spiritual heart and bastion of the chapter. Deploying land speeders, land raiders, and other armored vehicles in battle, the 7th Company, alike to the Siege Hammers, employ more flexible battle tactics than their battle company brethren. The 8th Reserve Company, Dawn's Huskarls, bear the legacy of the Legion's reformation in the aftermath of the War of the Beast. Formed by the former Black Templar, Helbrand Elderic, the 8th Company would from their inception be characterized by furious close combat assaults. Elderic would be demoted from the rank of captain by the chapter master of the Imperial Fists, Maximus Fane, and the 8th Company, comprised heavily with former Black Templars, would be redistributed among the companies of the Imperial Fists to temper their aggression. Serving as stoic and venerated exemplars of the Imperial Fists, Fane would recognize their unfettered rage in battle to have tempered their souls, and with new insight, restore Alderic and his company to the 8th. A proving ground for graduates drawn from the 10th Company, the 8th Company allows their wild nature to be vented to mold new battle brothers of the chapter into indomitable warriors. The 9th Reserve Company, the Wardens, train its members in the arts of siege breaking. Unofficially recognized as a battle company in its own right, the Wardens specialize in maneuvering to advantageous vantage points, installing defensive static positions and armored assaults. Patience, among the company's greatest virtues, the Wardens are renowned for their discipline and regular usage of the chapter's infamous pain glove. And finally, the 10th Reserve Company, the Eyes of Dawn, act as the scouts of the Imperial Fists. To bolster battlefield intelligence for their brother companies, the Eyes of Dawn must ascend to the rank of full battle brothers through deeds in order to earn the right to carry heavy armaments into battle. Recruitment into the Imperial Fist chapter proves to be a challenge. As a fleet-based chapter, the Gene Sons of Dawn nonetheless have advantages over their peers. Their storied defense of Holy Terra provides ample opportunities for recruits to be drawn from the Throne World. Supplemental initiates are gathered from numerous other worlds, with the most prominent outside the Sol system being Necromunda. Maintaining several fortress chapels across Imperial space, these outposts fall under the jurisdiction of veterans of the chapter, often grievously wounded and unfit to serve within future campaigns. Holding no claim to the worlds they inhabit, the veterans of the chapter utilize several means of testing and recruiting neophytes. Enticing recruits by holding tournaments on stable worlds, those unfortunate enough to reside within crime-ridden hives often witness the criminal elements of the world's slaughter at the hands of the 7th. And renounce their life of crime if showing promise in the eyes of the veterans. For the Imperial Fists do not discriminate neophytes for the manner of their birth, only the potential and future glories they may bring in service to the chapter. Remolding each aspirant into stoic warriors characterized by the virtues inherited from the heritage of the 7th, each neophyte seeks to embody the example of Rogal Dorn's quintessence. Appraised in their selection process for their reflexes, muscular suitability to implantation, pain tolerance, and dexterity, the Imperial Fists are meticulous in their selection of prospective Astartes. Proven aspirants will study within the phalanx for 6 Terran standard months and be taught to speak low Gothic, venerate the histories of the chapter, and understand the burden required to carry of each battle brother of the chapter. Initiation is conducted with the so-called Tunnel of Terror, where aspirants undergo environmental conditions such as extreme heat, bitter cold, and the embrace of the void. Should the aspirant survive the tunnel, they shall be branded with the mark of the Imperial Fists and begin the psycho-indoctrination, training, and surgeries to become an Astartes. Those who survive these trials are ordered to consume poisonous plant life and venomous creatures as a symbol of their duty to endure corruption and master pain. Informing the aspirant's family of their success in the trials, should they have any kin, it is an honor for any subject of the Imperium to rejoice at their son's ascension as a Space Marine. For they shall bring valor to the chapter in the name of the God Emperor of Mankind. The Geneseed of the Imperial Fists is incredibly stable in comparison to its counterparts from other legions. Showing no signs of mutation, the gene stock of the Imperial Fists has regardless shown signs of degeneration with time. Astartes of the 7th are unable to utilize the acidic-inducing Belcher's gland, nor the Susan membrane, which allows the Astartes to lay in a state of prolonged hibernation. Space Marines of the Imperial Fists indulge in scrimshawing the bones of the dead during their free time and conduct this peculiar quirk with somber care. Etching markings into the bones of the fallen, this chapter-wide practice focuses the Space Marines' minds, despite the origins of such a practice being lost to history. Wearing their grim ornamentations into battle, this practice occupies each waking hour that an Astartes partakes when not in or preparing for battle. Engraving the bones of their kin with devotional scripts and the deeds of their cherished fallen, the Imperial Fists carry these tokens into battle with pride. The toll incurred from the chapter's endless campaigns weighs heavily upon the hearts of the chapter, with several succumbing to varying stages of their Primarch's gene flaw. Burdened with duties beyond any of his brothers, Rogal Dorn's ceaseless devotion to preserve the Imperium under the constant strain of its assault would be inherited by his sons. Believing themselves to be defective in their pursuit to overcome overwhelming odds, the first stage of the curse of the Seventh is to suffer, not failure. Brooding on the mistakes of past battles, such Astartes shall seek to root out his own weaknesses, and should he be heedless, to beware hubris, forever fall short of the deeds of his genesire. Finally, he shall come to understand that none are flawless, and pore over the deeds of every one of his battle brothers, and withdraw as an obsessive, confrontational, and uncompromising soul. Often resorting to flagellation within the chapter's pain gloves for the smallest of infractions, the chapter's example of self-sacrifice runs deep within their blood. Yet another flaw is sown within the soul of the Imperial Fists, known as Dawn's Darkness. Inflicted upon every successor of the Imperial Fist Legion, the affliction begins with a blank gaze, a tremor of the limb, or slackness in the jaw. Drowning in the guilt of the wounding of the Emperor experienced by Rogal Dorn, the imprint of the Emperor's fall suffocates those afflicted with unending misery and paralytic fear. Unable to communicate, eat, or feel emotions beyond their torment, such a flaw is an ignominious fate for any son of Dorn. The Imperial Fist's proclivity for mechanized warfare and fortification embodies the chapter's fascination with organization, discipline, and doctrine. Fastidious in their implementation of battle strategies and cooperation with allied forces, the Imperial Fists have been a boon for the Death Watch since its inception by the chapter and influence in the Order's organization. A hardy chapter, characterized by traditions, honor duels, and rites of passage, the Imperial Fists enshrine their reputation as gallant warriors of the Imperium. Revering the last remnant of their former fortress monastery, lost during the Siege of Terra upon the Throne World, the Pillar of Bone is surrounded by the chapter's most holy relics. Alongside the Column of Glory, a crystalline pillar in the shadow of the Emperor's Golden Throne Room, fragments of fallen Imperial Fists who fell in defense of the Imperial Palace embed the structure. Serving as reminders to each Astartes of the Seventh of their glory in defending the Emperor's Palace, the interred bones of their ancestors and monuments of their service imbue their chapter with pride. A testament to their great sacrifice to humanity, the Imperial Fists embody their genefather's courage and defiance to surrender to the ruinous powers. Driven to serve as the embodiments of their Primarch's indomitable strength, the Imperial Fists refuse to withdraw from battle when lesser men would retreat. Relentless in their persecution of the wicked souls who would dare to stand against the Imperium, the descendants of the Throne World's vigilant guardians shall never break under the weight of their eternal burden. Paragons of duty, order, and sacrifice, the Imperial Fists stand ready for the return of their Primarch and the last war to destroy the enemies of humanity. For the Seventh has stood at the breaking point of every war to vanquish the Imperium, and so long as their vigil remains, no foe of the Emperor shall prevail.
"The time for speeches is done," said Dorn. "The first great test is here. My order to you all is simple, yet heed it well, and exert yourselves to see it done. They are coming. Kill them all."
This has been a tale of the Great Imperium of Man, read by the Remembrancer. The Praetorians of Terra are the stalwart defenders of humanity, for though their shields may be splintered, their resolve is as unyielding as stone. Yet in my next transmission of the Legiones Astartes, we shall elucidate the relentless spear tip of the traitor Astartes, the fallen legion of the Warmaster, the Sons of Horus.